for instance, sound that the man made with, that's always so popular.
Never had any formal training, and I think maybe it's just that I might be a baritone with a real high range, 2.5 octaves or so, but I've never checked it. I started singing this way because I was writing songs, and I wrote the melody that I heard in my head, and so then I had to sing those notes as well, and I didn't know how high or low you were supposed to go, so I went where I wanted to. I could smile for
a while, but I tried to sing along with it, and of course it sounded like a wounded duck because of his range. And it was something to sing along with, to learn how to sing. Couldn't tell that I'd been crying. If you could sing along with it, you became aware of how to make your voice do things that you might not have understood.
There was something about Roy's voice that was completely unique to him, which was obviously a good thing because it was hard to emulate. That had this sort of, and I always think this is a good actor, sort of, it had a crying sound to it. It almost was like a controlled cry.
His performance would just tear your heart out. He could express all that emotion, and he was really different than anybody else. I love you even more than I did before, but darling, what can I do?
I think Roy's voice is like an opera voice, only sexy. Where opera voices are kind of, to me, they're not sexy because just the music they're singing. But Roy doing rock and roll and blues, and you know, blue notes and things with that kind of opera voice. Now that made it really different, and it put like an opera slant on a rock and roll track. It's wonderful and it's sad at the same time because that's the inflection. And he puts into the soulfulness of his voice. You know, he's got marvellous soul. I think that's, he was probably a soul singer before any of them, you know. Like Elvis said, oh, ladies and gentlemen, best singer in the world right there, Roy Orbison. And probably because he was the best singer of all. Golden days before they
end. Roy's entry into the British music scene had been a triumph, with It's Over topping the UK charts in 1964. But personal tragedy would soon threaten to end Roy's career. In 1966, his wife Claudette was killed in a motorbike accident. And there was even more heartbreak to come.
We had this beautiful boy called Roy Dwight. I used to take him to the zoo and take him around, and I loved his company. He was like a really sweet kid. And I remember once I came back to the promotion offices in Great Marlborough Street, the Decca offices, and Roy Dwight, I'd exhausted him. and he was must have been about six or seven. He wasn't a baby. And I'd had to carry him back to the office because he was so exhausted he fell asleep. And I remember carrying him, and I remember his little head on my shoulder. And then he got burned to death in that fire.
We'd been playing the Birmingham Theatre for a week. This was September 68. And the following day, we were going to do the last performance, which was a concert in Bournemouth. And then he was going to be flying back to the US. That was the end of the tour. I got the call about 3 o'clock in the morning, local time in England.
Send falling stars that seem to cry.
He was on tour in England. And he got the news over there that his house had burned and he had lost two of his boys.
I remember thinking, how is that man going to cope with that?
He stayed in seclusion for quite a while. We made contact and let him know we cared and were concerned. And it was a long time until I saw Roy. Because it wasn't something that he was wanting to talk about.
Well, to be quite honest, I really thought at that particular point in time that that we would never see him again. I thought that would be he had not worked really since Claudette had died. However, and I did get another call in saying that he was coming back.
To a large extent, Roy's return had been made possible by someone he had met and fallen in love with before the fire.
We started dating, and 6 weeks later, the house fire happened in Hendersonville, Tennessee. But I think it was such a gift for him to have fallen in love with me before. So he did have a focus. It gave him a chance to create a life that he really wanted, and that was one of a real stable family and to have more kids.
You know, Roy just had such an incredible, gentle strength. He scaled the heights and the lows.
Lonely Riverside, wait for me.
I arrived in December of 68 in Tennessee, and then we traveled in America and we got married in March. We had Roy Kelton Jr., who was born in 1970, and then Alex in 74, and we had Wesley from the marriage with Claudette. If you would have seen Roy with the kids, you would have never suspected that he had lost two kids in a house fire while he was touring in England.
He came through it in a really great way, a very surprising way. He came back stronger than ever after this terrible loss of his two boys. He came back with all of the determination and the will to go ahead and to be the great artist he is.
As the 70s dawned, a new look Roy returned again and again to tour for his UK fans. And of course, the Orbison family went too.
Pretty woman, walking down the street, pretty.
When it was tour time, we all went. We went, nannies, everybody just went out on the road. Baby formulas, baby cribs, pramulators, whatever it took, you know.
Mercy.
We would be, tours or no tours, probably 4 or 5 months out of the year in London. We practically lived here in the 70s and loved it.
He loved England. He loved the British people. There was something about Britain or the British people that Roy liked.
You know, I think that was a love affair. You know, Roy Orbison loved. Roy loved England. I mean, he loved everything about it. He loved the food, and that was tough to love in the 60s.
He came up to my house in the Midlands, and he brought with him, he showed me in his trunk, he said, look at this, he had a driver and that, and he said, look what I've brought. And he'd got like four sets of pie and mash, for everybody, Brought it all the way from London. Pretty woman,
say you'll stay. Roy, I think, just loved the English way of life.
He would love to listen to accents and go and see places in Scotland and go and visit castles and walk the hills. Nutcase. We were in bed, he was walking the hills. He just loved Britain, he really did. And we loved him.
He was very real. He wasn't slick and he wasn't show busy. He didn't have a pattern on, he wasn't a schmoozy kind of guy.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate you coming tonight very much. We're happy to be here, hope you are.
He was that same person, on stage and off stage. It was never about ego. It was just about being himself.
Only the lonely know the way I feel tonight.
It's inherent in the British nature to admire modesty, especially when it's accompanied with a great talent.
There goes my baby.
He was a shy man, a family man, a quiet man. Who he was just as much a part of everything as what he was singing.
By the time we got married, all that was important was to have a great relationship and to live life and to sort of like mend, those incredible painful times and to really enjoy life and do what he felt he was called on this earth for. And he said, for that I will go anywhere, smallest club, biggest arenas, whatever.
Roy still had a loyal following. The mid-70s saw a change in the British music scene. The rejection of all things mainstream and the stripped-down instrumentation of punk rock seemed, at first glance, to leave little room for the Big O.
Pretty woman, won't you pardon me, pretty woman? Couldn't help but see, pretty woman, you look lovely.
See, I can't get up now. When I was in the Sex Pistols, if you were a closet music fan like myself, there's loads of bands who I would have probably got hung for if it would have gotten out that I liked at the time, Would he come under that umbrella as it's old hat and you shouldn't be liking them because we're against all that nonsense? I don't think that is the case. I don't think he ever fell into that bag as being out of flavour,
When I was growing up in the 70s, Roy was kind of an anachronism, really. He was completely out of kilter with the times. And people I was hanging out with didn't have Roy Orbison albums. They just didn't. He was from a different era. But then as the 70s begat punk rock, there became an interest in the 50s. I think it was, punk rock was a 50s thing in a way, rebel without a cause, the short haircuts, the stance of Elvis, stripping things down to the bone. So it was through the door that punk rock opens that Roy Orbison walked into my life.
You have to remember, Roy didn't get to be Roy Orbison by being like anything but outside the norm. Those guys in Memphis, when they created rockabilly. You know, they didn't create rockabilly by being the boy next door. Just